In the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most gracious, most merciful. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen, all praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer of one and all. That's just the meaning of Rabb. Ra and Ba, two Ba's. Creator, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer of one and all, and possibly and probably and definitely much, much more than that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really and truly grant us all acceptance, and may He shower us with His mercy at all times. Wa usalli wa usallim ala khatam al-anbiya'i wal-mursaleen, nabiyyina wa habibina wa qudwatina wa imamina Muhammad ibn Abdullahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'ina wa tabi'ina wa man tabi'ahum bi ihsanin ila yawmiddini wa ba'd. Complete and perfect blessings and salutations be upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all his companions. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all the previous prophets as well as all those who followed them. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us as followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all his companions as well as our offspring, those to come up to the day of Qiyamah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us all on the straight path. Ameen. My dearest brothers and sisters in Islam, I'm very honored to be standing here in front of you this evening, sharing with you the most powerful words. The most powerful words are the words of our own Creator. If I were to ask you, have you read some books? You'd say, yes, we've read a lot of books. We're forced to read books because we're at varsity. How many books have you read? I don't know, I've lost count. That's true. Have you ever read the Quran? A lot of us, almost all of us, would say, yes, well, I did. Did you read it in Arabic or English? Everyone will say in Arabic, and some of us may say in English as well. Did you understand it? I think a lot of us who are non-Arabs would probably say, no. Well, what did you do about trying to understand it? You know what? I heard from some Mawlana, I heard from some Sheikh that it's haram to read the English. Wow. Is that what you heard? Is this a Da Vinci Code? Is this something really that is a big secret like the Freemasons? What is it? Allahu Akbar. How can you say, I'm not allowed to read the English language? أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Allah says in the Quran, are they not going to try to understand the Quran, or are its locks on their hearts? May we not be from amongst those on whose hearts are the locks. Seal, we don't want to understand the word of the Creator. The one who created me and you, he has a word. You know, when you buy a new computer, when you have a little gadget that you bought, you purchased, you need to know how to use it. You would either have a person who will train you, or you will have a manual, or you will have both. So the person will train you and leave the manual with you, so that when he's gone, you'll have the manual. And if you're stuck, you can get back to him and say, you know what, I tried to read the manual to operate this gadget, but it is you who can help me understand. We would do that for a simple gadget, to operate it in the correct manner. We are the most sophisticated of the creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have a manual and an instructor who came with that manual, and he taught us and he left the manual with us, and we have people who will continue explaining to us. That is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after giving this manual that is the Quran, how to achieve success in my life and yours, He has given it to us in book form. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالزُّبُرِ. If you don't understand the scriptures, ask those who know, they will answer your questions. So you should try to understand it, but naturally there will be certain questions. When you read a big book at this university, there are certain things you'll understand very easily in that book. Like the Quran, the bulk of it is very simply understood. Those who do good will go to Jannah. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ الْجَنَّةِ. Those who believe and do good deeds shall go to Jannah. We hear that. We understand it. Anyone didn't understand that? Quite simple to understand. Those who do evil, Allah says, وَجَزَاءُ سَيِّئَةٍ سَيِّئَةٌ مِثْلُهَا. Those who do evil shall receive something similar in as a recompense for that particular item that they've done. So is that difficult to understand? You know, it's the tit for tat mentality, isn't it? That's what we say. You do something, for every action, there is a reaction. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills, He can punish us for our sins. If He wills, He can forgive us. Without even, sometimes, in fact, through His mercy alone, without us saying anything. We deserve punishment, but He holds it back, He doesn't. He continues giving us goodness, and another try, and another chance, and so on, until a long, long time. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us turn before punishment overtakes us. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran,
وَأَنِيبُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ وَأَسْلِمُوا لَهُ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَكُمُ الْعَذَابُ ثُمَّ لَا تُنصَرُونَ
Turn to Allah. Turn to Allah, repent to Him, find the way to Him before the punishment overtakes you. Then it will be too late. Nobody will help you. The verse just before that says, punishment may overtake you suddenly. So we don't want that to happen to us. And what I'm saying is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted us so much, sometimes we don't even deserve it. You know the air we breathe, to be honest with you, in countries where the air is polluted, people realize the value of that air. I'm waiting for the day when we will be charged to breathe, believe me. You know you have this carbon tax, we will have breath tax. I promise you, it's coming because there will be oxygen zones, everywhere will be polluted air, and then you have a zone where you go in and you can breathe as much oxygen pure as you want, you put a few pennies, it gives you a little bit of gas and you walk up. The day may come, it may. Looking at the pollution happening across the globe, it may come. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to understand the gift of oxygen, the breath. We breathe without even thinking, imagine no battery, no nothing. Allahu Akbar. And that is the gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has this manual. Are we going to try and understand it? Amazing. If we read the books, as I was saying, here at this university, we probably understand a lot, but there will be certain issues we don't understand. Who do you ask? You'd ask your lecturer. You'd ask someone who knows to say, look, you know what? I was swatting, I was reading, I was studying for my exams, and this was something that I did not understand. Can you explain it to me? And they will probably say, yes, listen, sit down. Firstly, how many pounds are you paying? Yes. It can happen. They could charge you, you know. A friend sometimes doesn't have a lot of time. Sometimes. That's what it is. So, whatever happens, you want to know, you will even pay to find out. What does this mean? And sometimes they might tell you, you know what, just memorize it as it is and just write it. If you ask the question, just write it. Just memorize these words. That's it. So, the Quran has verses. The bulk of them are clearly understood, as I've given you examples. Like the stories of the previous prophets. In this particular surah, there's a story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, which takes the bulk of Surah Taha. Then there is a little bit of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam and what happened at his time. And that takes up part of the surah as well, and the lessons drawn therefrom. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it so simple to understand. Today I'd like to show you how to extract the jewels, the pearls from this particular surah. And obviously from that, inshallah, I wish, my intention is to create the thirst within all of us to try and understand the Quran, to do something to understand the message of Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, the Creator Himself. Right? So the bulk of the verses easily understood. If I would like to derive a true benefit from those verses which have mentioned previous messengers, how do I derive that benefit? One of the best ways is to make yourself a member of that community momentarily, to pretend like you were there. So when you are reading about Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, just pretend you are there. Pretend you're in the story. And ask yourself, where do I fit in? Am I on this side or that side? I know myself better than anybody else, and you know yourselves better than anybody else knows you. So you would know exactly where you fitted in. If you oppress people, you probably fit in with Fir'aun and Qarun and Haman. And if you were a person who was oppressed, and people are harassing you and troubling you, and you're feeling the oppression of others, then put yourself on the side of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And if you're a person who's just an onlooker, you feel neither have you been oppressed, nor do you oppress others, you're just in the middle. Or you feel that you really, really cannot imagine yourself fitting in somewhere there, then the minimum you need to do is to draw and extract lessons from the particular surah, and inshallah that will be happening through the help of the mufassireen, those experts of hadith of the Quran, those who have actually gone into the verses of the Quran and extracted for us the jewels. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inshallah make this eve an eve where all of us that are seated here can move an inch closer to him inshallah, at least. Ameen. The second type of verses in the Quran, those when you read them, a question comes up in your mind. A question comes up in your mind, not so easily understood. Sometimes you might read a verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about alcohol and he says,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لَا تَقْرَبُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَأَنْتُمْ سُكَارَى.
O you who believe, do not come close to salah, to prayer, in the state of intoxication. When you read that, you say, what does this mean? Does this mean, when I'm not reading salah, then it's fine. You might ask yourself a question, but I'm a Muslim, I know alcohol is haram. So what is this all about? If you don't really know abrogation and what it means and so on, known in the Arabic language as naskh, and if you don't know what exactly that verse implies or what it means and when it was in action and so on, you need to ask someone, or you need to research it, find out. And it's very important that each one of us looks into whom we are asking. انظروا ممن تأخذون دينكم. Make sure you know who you are taking your deen from. That manual, who is explaining it to you? If you are to ask people who are shady, phony, you can use a lot of other words, then what would happen? You would become one of them, also shady and phony. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Not a mobile phone, but another type of phony. So you need to ask someone who knows, someone whom you rely on, someone whom you can trust, you know their knowledge, someone whom people have referred you to, people whom you trust have referred you to. Look, ask this person, they will give you the knowledge and so on, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who can seek from those who are true Muslimin, true ulama, true scholars of this deen. So that's the second type of verse. It would be wrong for us not to ask and to arrive at our own conclusions when we read a verse. So someone sees a verse, for example, and they have a question, but they then decide, I think it means this. They will probably arrive at the wrong answers. And this is why Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said that مَنْ قَالَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ بِرَأْيِهِ فَقَدْ أَخْطَأَ وَإِنْ أَصَابَ. Whoever speaks regarding the Quran with his own opinion has made a mistake, even if he's right. Because what was wrong was to use your own opinion. That is the portion that was wrong. So if a person answers a question that has come up in their minds after reading a verse of the Quran, on their own they answer it, they are wrong. Because they don't have the qualification to actually look into it. Even if the rare case, they do happen to say that which is correct. You need to confirm it, verify it. This is something important. And I'd like to quickly mention some points where people have deviated in this regard. Sometimes people who want to cause a problem amongst the Muslims, they show them a verse in the Quran. A verse connected to one of the battles that took place at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the battles where the history is mentioned, what happened is mentioned, and sometimes it's mentioned in first person. It's taken quotations and it's put there in the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, in the Battle of Badr, he's given so many instructions. There is one instruction which says, go out and kill them, the infidels. Allahu Akbar. Okay? So people will show you the verse and they'll say, look, your Quran, here it is, here's the verse. This is the verse. You guys, you preach terrorism. Come on. Just acknowledge it. And then Muslims who don't know, there is a question in their minds. Well, it's the fastest growing religion on the globe. And here's somebody showing me something. It's the Quran. I can see it. It's Yusuf Ali. The translation. Oh, this translation is Noble Quran. Medina. Hey. It says yes. Oh. you turn away. Why? Can there be something wrong in that? Does it apply to me and you today? You need to say, hang on, I'll ask somebody who knows and I'll get back to you. And then you open books of British history and you find stories, or you find in the history, they narrate what happened in the Falklands. And the commander said, fire and kill all of them. In inverted commas. Does that mean that rule applies to every British who's living in Britain? Fire and kill everybody else? Is that what it means? It doesn't. So you can take that book and show them, hey, hang on, come, you're British? Look at this, you guys are terrorists. What would they say? You're a fool, this is Falklands. This is what happened years back, come on. That's the quotation of a commander there. That applied there and in that war. Well, the same applies to this verse in the Quran. Allahu Akbar. So don't come and misinterpret and misunderstand verses of the Quran. This is something that applied then. And let nobody confuse you regarding the purity of the Quran and the message of peace promoted in the Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So this is the danger of not asking. When you arrive at your own answers, you don't have answers, you feel embarrassed, you feel there's nothing to be embarrassed about. Then the third type of verse, nobody knows the meaning of. Or the bulk of the Mufassireen say, no one knows the meaning of. Those who believe, they say, look, we take the verse as it is. Didn't I tell you moments ago, someone might come to you and say, listen, you know what, I can't really explain this to you, but just memorize it as it is. And if you asked about it, you answer it exactly as you memorized it. I said that moments ago. So in the Quran, for example, if I were to say, Hamim Ayn Sin Qaf. Translate that for me, you say, Allah knows best. Stop there. You memorize it as it is, these are known as huruf muqatta, separated letters. Allah knows the exact meaning. That's it, and we are moving on. Last night I spoke about a little bit of these particular letters and what they served as. And because Surah Taha commences with two of these letters, Taha, I think it's only correct for me to mention it today again. These are known as separated letters. All the surahs that have separated letters were revealed in Makkah. Besides the first two that have separated letters, Alif Lam Mim, Surah Al-Baqarah, and Al Imran, the other Alif Lam Mim, the second one. Those two, the bulk of what was revealed in those surahs was in Madinatul Munawwarah. The rest of the surahs that have these separated letters, the minute you hear a separated letter, Noon, Qaf, Saad, any of these letters, or Hamim, Alif Lam Mim, Taseen, they were all revealed in Makkatul Mukarramah. So, what was it? The Arabs, at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the bulk of them were unlettered. Allah says, هو الذي بعث في الأميين رسولا منهم. Allah sent to the nation of those who were unlettered a messenger from amongst them. The bulk of them were unlettered. There were few who could read or write. They were well known. But they were extremely eloquent. They could speak. When they spoke language, it was so powerful and solid. Subhanallah. They were poets, they were linguists, they knew exactly what to say, when to say, how to say it, and so on. And they amazed and amused. They had little conferences and conventions where they would stand up and begin to recite poetry, and everyone was actually shocked and mesmerized. So, when the Quran came, it was so powerful, but it was not poetry, nor was it a song. It was something in the middle. It was not even just ordinary speech. It was something that rhymed to a certain extent. It had powerful messages, but it was not poetry because it didn't have a wazn. It didn't have an actual weight of the sides of the couplets. It didn't really have couplets. So, because of the power of this Quran, the people of Makkah found that anyone who listened to the Quran automatically digested the message and inclined towards it. They inclined towards it. Here we are talking of kuffar. Look, alhamdulillah, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are seated here, bi-idhnillah. Bi-idhnillah, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who are genuine Muslims, inshallah. We are seated here as Muslimin. They were kuffar, enemies of Islam, idol worshippers, Idol worshippers, worse than Jews and Christians. They were not even people of the book. They were not. And when they heard a few verses of the Quran, it moved them completely. They began to weep and cry, and they turned and they changed their lives. Because they understood the message in very few verses. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed in Mecca a certain type of verses. Do you know why? Because the kuffar of Mecca, the leaders began to say, and Allah says it in the Quran,
وَقَالَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَا تَسْمَعُوا لِهَذَا الْقُرْآنِ وَالْغَوْا فِيهِ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَغْلِبُونَ
The kuffar used to say, don't listen to the Quran. Make a noise whilst it's being recited so that you can be victorious. So that you can be victorious. Why? Because they knew anyone who listened to this Quran, we were losing them to Islam. We were losing them to Islam. So, what did they used to do? Put their fingers into their ears. The minute a verse starts, they put their fingers into their ears. But the verses of Mecca, nearly all of them were short and sharp. Short and sharp verses.
عَمَّ يَتَسَاءَلُونَ
The verse is over. So, when they heard عَمَّ and they began to put their fingers into their ears, they heard يَتَسَاءَلُونَ As the finger plugged in properly, the verse was over, it gave them time to concentrate and digest the verse. Allahu Akbar. Imagine. That was the power of the verses of Mecca. Then, when they thought, now it's all over, let's take our fingers out, they heard عَنِن نَبَئِ الْعَظِيمِ And they quickly put their fingers back. And they said, عَنِن نَبَئِ What's this نَبَئُ الْعَظِيمِ? What is it? What's this all about? And they said, anyway, we're not supposed to be listening.
الَّذِي هُمْ فِيهِ مُخْتَلِفُونَ
And they put their ears back again. And in that way, they digested verse after verse, subhanAllah.
يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّثِّرِ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ
And so on. Amazing, the power of the verses of Mecca. Short, sharp verses. Imagine, listen to this one.
وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى
Do you notice how they're becoming slightly longer? Because it creates an interest in the heart of those who want to understand it, and the meaning of it is so powerful that they don't really comprehend. It's never happened that people have sworn an oath by the dawn. It's never happened that people have sworn an oath by the sun.
وَالشَّمْسِ
It's never happened that people have sworn an oath by the night.
وَاللَّيْلِ
Allahu Akbar. So when they heard this, they were so amused and amazed, they were digesting it, and then they were just like, you know, gobsmacked, so to speak. And, hey, did you hear that? Now there was a new type of a power. Verses, nobody knows the meanings, not even the most eloquent of Arabs.
Taha.
Hey, what the heck does that mean? I've never heard it. Separated letters? Imagine if I were to try that in the English language. Here we all speak English, don't we?
K-M-C.
You would look at me and say, this guy's mad. He's mad. And then when you know, but look, he's one of the most eloquent of all of us. You would come, imagine the literary, a person whom everybody looked up to for language, meaning for speech. He might be unlettered, but for speech. He was so powerful. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he said something like that, you'd have to go to him, hang on, that was an abbreviation, wasn't it? No, it wasn't. I was just making a fool of all of you. Or if they had to say KMC, for example, we'd probably come up with something. Maybe it means K might stand for Kellogg's, M might stand for, I don't know, something else, and C might stand for chocolate, you see? We might come up with anything. But that, what did it do? It created an interest. So when the verse Taha was revealed, it was a verse. Amazing. It created a big interest. Now, what happened? And I'm moving into the surah, and I'm only going to take snippets, because the surah is so long, I'm just going to give you the gist of the surah. If you take a look at the next part, straight after Allah says, Taha, what does he say? He clarifies something so huge. There was a very big misconception, and for your information, that misconception exists to date. As well as among some of us, some Muslims ask the same question. What is the question? Why does Islam have so many rules? Why?
Why do you have to do this, do that, do that, eat salah, do this, stay away from that, stay. Why do you have so many rules? For what? It's making everybody distressed. It's causing a problem. I know of so many people who are not Muslim, whom I have spoken to, and sometimes they tell you, you know, I know Islam is right. I know it's the correct religion, but hang on, there's just a little bit too much in terms of rules and regulations, and you know, I'm finding it difficult, I can't. I'm sorry, I'm not ready to accept it right now. They'll tell you that. They say, because it's going to make my life stressful. That was the statement of those who worship idols at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They used to discourage everyone by saying, you want to follow this religion, it's got so many rules. It's going to make your life full of distress. Look, anyone who follows it suddenly is a different person. They've got to watch out the timing. They've got to watch out their cleanliness. They've got to look at their dress. They've got to look at this and that and so on. Allahu Akbar. Why do you want to do that? So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, do you know what happened to him? He once walked out of his house. He was one of the biggest enemies of Islam. He hated the Muslims. He hated them. And he says, I want to just destroy this man. Finished. If I destroy him, it'll be over. And he walked out. But just prior to that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had inspired Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made a dua. Allahumma a'izzal islama bi ahadil umarain. O Allah, grant strength to this Islam by the acceptance of the religion by one of the two Umars, either Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu or Amr ibn Hisham, who was also known as Abu Jahl. Abu Jahl, his name was Amr ibn Hisham. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu came out just after the dua of his house with a sword, and he was walking straight, quick. He was asking, where's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He was met on the road by somebody. And he says, I'm going to kill him. So that somebody said, why do you want to start with him? Charity begins at home. Your sister's accepted the message. Come on, go and start with her. He says, yes, that makes sense. Let me sort my sister out. And he went to sort his sister out. Allah had a plan. Allahu Akbar. Anyway, it's a story. The history is written. I'm sure a lot of us would know it. But in a nutshell, when he got to his sister's house and he beat them up and there was blood all over and he saw the blood and he felt, look, what were you people doing? Khabbab ibn al-Arab, what were you people doing? And they said, no, you know, we were reading the Quran, but you're not allowed to touch these. You need to cleanse and wash yourself first, you know. Anyway, he said, look, I want to read it, so let me cleanse and wash myself. Let me see what you guys are following here. So he came, he read these verses, the opening verses of Surah Taha, and the issues he had were clarified there immediately. One of the issues was too many rules, regulations. Allah says, after he says Taha, he says,
مَا أَنزَلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْقُرْآنَ لِتَشْقَى إِلَّا تَذْكِرَةً لِمَنْ يَخْشَى تَنزِيلًا خلق الأرض والسماوات العلى.
That was enough. Allah says, we have not revealed this Quran to you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so that it can be a point of distress for you. No, there's no distress in the Quran. It's not difficult. All these rules and regulations that have been revealed are not there to create distress for you. They are actually there to make your life easy, to let it flow. It's actually now following the manual we were talking about moments ago. When you see a thick manual, you would actually say, wow, that gadget must be complex. And when you see a little manual, you say, no, this must be some Chinese stuff. No offense to the Chinese. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Now in Zimbabwe, normally, you know, when people come late, we tell them, do you have a Chinese battery, brother? In your watch, which means, you know, take it easy. I know that it must have stopped somewhere down the line. Anyway, getting back to what we were saying, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clarifies this immediately to say that this verse, meaning these verses that we've revealed, are not revealed for you. These rules and regulations that we've revealed are not revealed for you to be in distress and to make your life stressful, not at all. It is only but a reminder for those who have a little bit of consciousness and fear of their Creator. If you want to know more about your Creator, there's the Quran. He is telling you firsthand.
And we know, I know and you know, that it is the book that is memorized by the most of people. Do you know if you were or I were to write my own story, one page? If I write, and I challenge anyone, you write your own story, something created from your head, one page of it, with full stops and commas and exclamation marks and so on and so forth, one page. And then I tell you, listen, memorize what you've written and come and say it out here. Your own writing, it will be extremely difficult. You'd need to be a genius to actually get that exactly as it is. And then again, I would guess you'd probably make a mistake when you got up to say it, though it was your own. You did it yourself. You wrote it from your mind. But this is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ. This verse has a split meaning, two meanings. One, we have made this Quran easy for you to memorize. Is anyone going to memorize it? And the other is, we have made this Quran easy to understand. Is anyone from amongst you going to try and understand this Quran? Allahu Akbar. لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكِرٍ. Is anyone from amongst you going to try to understand this Quran? If you do, it will result in your success. That is in Surah Al-Qamar. And in that surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the previous nations. And we need to understand the stories of the previous nations in order to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's plan. Do you see, if a log together with petrol, together with a flame, made an inferno 5,000 years ago, do you think that today, if we have a log with petrol, with a match, for example, that it will not make an inferno? We're foolish if we think that. If it made an inferno so many years back, it's going to make another inferno today. So if people were transgressing and did not obey the message for years on end in the past, and after those years on end, they were overtaken with punishment at that time, do we think we will get away by continuing to do the same things that resulted in punishment that time now without getting punishment? Then we'd be foolish. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this book is revealed for those who want. For those who want to understand. Those who have that consciousness of Allah. Those who have the fear of Allah. That means, those who do not have that consciousness, will it be a point of memory for them? No, it won't. Will it be a reminder for them? No, it won't. Will it be a point of goodness for them? In fact, they won't even want to read. They won't even want to know the message. And Allah says, it is a revelation. From the one who has created the skies and the earth, and whatever lies between the two. Subhanallah. That's the next verse. It is a revelation from the one who has created the skies and the earth. Amazing. Whatever lies in between. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created that. So this is the first point that I wanted to mention, that this Quran really has rules and regulations that are so powerful, but they are there to make our lives easy. The more rules you have, the more regulations you have, the more streamlined you will be, the more disciplined you shall be, the better a person you will be, and inshallah, the more successful you will be in life. When you have a workplace, your own, say you're the boss, and you have people working for you, if you've got no rules, no regulations, people will come dressed as they want, people will come at any time they want, people will do whatever they want to do, they will phone whomsoever they wish to phone, connected or not connected to the work. They will sit all day on the internet and so on, and you will fail. But if you put down rules and regulations, listen, you come into work here, this is how you're going to be dressed, this is what time you're going to come, this is what you're going to be doing, this is where you're going to sit, this is the time for lunch, and that's the break you're going to have, and please, no pork. And so on. You can make your rules. The more rules you make, the more streamlined you shall be, the more successful your business will be. So whenever there are more rules, you will generally find that particular business more successful than those who move haphazardly. The same applies to religion. We have a religion. Subhanallah, it has the most rules and regulations from all other religions. And inshallah, that is the way forward, inshallah. We must not feel. Look, I'd like to let you know one thing. Sometimes we are all weak. Every single one of us are all trying to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us have succeeded in dealing with the external part before the internal part. Some of us have succeeded in dealing with the internal part before the external part. Some of us have succeeded in dealing with both of them together quite quickly, and some of them a little bit slowly. But we're all in the same boat. Don't we all want Jannah, paradise, every single one of us? And inshallah, we're getting there, inshallah. May Allah grant us all Jannah, inshallah, every single one of us. So it's a struggle. Don't judge a book by the cover. We've heard that so many times. The problem with us, you see someone, oh, you know what? This guy here is dressed in shorts. I'm not going to greet him. That thought has rendered you worse than him. Amazing. That thought has rendered you worse than him because he might be so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you don't know. He might have a single deed that is far better than all the deeds you've ever engaged in. Amazing. He might have helped someone, or she for that matter, might have assisted someone, or might have got up for tahajjud. Who knows? And you might never have. You might have missed your fajr so many times. Who knows? She might not be externally so appearing Muslim, but she might be regular with her salah and you might not be. Who knows? She might never have hurt a fellow Muslim ever. And you, with a beard from here to the ground and dragging 5 meters later, might have actually harmed everybody around you. Believe me. So, to judge people and to rule on people in Islam is absolutely forbidden. And those who do it are astray. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. What was Shaytan's crime? And I like to say this every time because it's so important. Shaytan said, "Ana khayrun minhu," I am better than him. That's it. The minute he said, "I'm better than him," it rendered him worse than everybody put together. And he was kicked out by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of the mercy of Allah. So if you are to judge someone and to start thinking for a moment in any way when it comes to spirituality and religion, then I am better. I am better. Automatically, you are asking for the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to descend on you. And you know what? It's like a person, Allah says, وَيَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ صُنْعًا. In Surah Al-Kahf, towards the end, Allah says, قُلْ هَلْ أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا. Should I inform you of those who have the lowest of deeds? Those who do good deeds, seemingly, they think they're doing good, and yet it's all bad, it's all evil. Why? Because their hearts are not clean. They think what they are on is correct and it's not correct. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us from amongst those. So it's a struggle. All of us are struggling. Another example I like to give is the example of a motor vehicle, and it's important. It's important we understand it, especially on campus here. We have the M6. I'm not going to say M1 because it's a little bit busy and you get traffic jams. Say the M6. You're driving. You're driving with the latest Mercedes, mashallah. And a person moves next to you with a registration plate of 1980. And he's got a vehicle that's no longer in existence. Some form of a Vauxhall, I don't know, whatever, you can think about it. And you zoom past him at 120 miles an hour, and he's moving at 60 with a bit of a bump. And you look at him and you laugh, "I've got a better vehicle. Don't worry, I'm going to get there before him." And suddenly, pop, and the tire bursts. What happened? Or suddenly, something went wrong, a little accident. And next thing, you were pulled off by the police. For what? For speeding. And this guy then, 1 hour later, he passes your milk and he says, "Hey guy, how are you doing? You alright?" And he carries on. Amazing. Who got to the destination first? The man who thought he was in a better vehicle? No. He might have been in a better vehicle, but he was stopped. Something went wrong. He had a puncture, for example, and he was stopped, and the other one, whom he thought was in a lower vehicle, had actually crossed and got to the destination before him. So, if we take this example and put it into our spirituality, some of us might be driving a spiritual Mercedes-Benz. And we're moving on the highway towards Jannah, and we have a puncture, some form of a spiritual breakdown in the process. And we were laughing at those whom we thought were in spiritual Vauxhalls, for example. And we looked at them on that highway going to Jannah, and then suddenly they zoomed past us when we get to Jannah. "But you've been here before me, what are you doing? I had the milk, come on, I had the beard from here. 10 meters, come on man. I'm supposed to have been there before you." That's not how Allah operates. Allahu Akbar. So let's understand this. Spirituality is something that should grow. And the way it grows is to respect others and respect their spirituality. That is why in Islam there is no odometer or there is no tag on my forehead and yours saying, right, this person is moving at this spiritual speed, or this person is this holy. Imagine if holiness was a figure, and it stopped at 100, and everyone 5, 10, 15, 12, 14, 16, what would happen? Allahu Akbar. There is nothing of that nature. It is kept hidden. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى لَا يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ صُوَرِكُمْ وَلَا إِلَىٰ أَجْسَامِكُمْ وَلَكِنْ يَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ قُلُوبِكُمْ وَأَعْمَالِكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at your outer, how beautiful you are, how wealthy you are, and so on. He looks at your deeds, the inside. Yes, it's a struggle. Everyone should try and get closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshaAllah. If we see someone doing something wrong, firstly, we should ask ourselves, what am I doing that's wrong? You should help them by encouraging them positively. Don't doom someone to the degree that they go away from deen because of you. Look at what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says regarding Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And we're getting to the story. He says, وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ مُوسَىٰ. That's the power of the Arabic language. And did the story come to you of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam? This is just a point of benefit as we're passing. One of the powers of the Arabic language is that it has the ability to be juggled in a manner that creates interest in the one who listens to it. So when Allah says, هَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ, the word Musa comes right at the end. Do you know one of the reasons why? Because when the kuffar heard وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ, someone may have thought, oh, Abu Jahl is going to be mentioned just now and exposed. Or Abu Sufyan is going to be mentioned and exposed. Or one of these leaders, Umayyah bin Khalaf, is going to be exposed just now. So, وَهَلْ أَتَاكَ حَدِيثُ. They didn't want to hear the verse, but they said, hang on, we need to know who. Did you hear the story about? And Musa alayhi salam is mentioned at the end. The name comes right at the end. So that they said, oh, Musa, hey, just as well it wasn't my name. Allahu Akbar. You see? So the kuffar heard the verse. That's the power of the language. Then Allah says, إِذَا آمَاهُمْ فَقَالَ لِأَهْنِهِمْ كُثُوا. Let me give you the picture. Let me tell you what happened. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam had just got married. He was going back. And he was in the desert. And it was a little bit nippy, a little bit cold. I don't think as cold as this place here. But what happened is, it was dark. He wasn't so sure of the road. And there were no satellite navigation systems as I had as I came here. And he thought, you know what? I can see a light at a distance. There must be a little bit of people sitting around gathering some flame, you know. Let me go there. He told his wife, look, you sit here. I'm coming just now. Let me go and see what's there. Let me go and see what's there. I will come back to you with a portion of the flame to keep you warm. And if they don't want to give me a portion of the flame, at least I will come to you with directions. Something. We will know, yes, you're heading in the right direction. Leads, yes, follow that road. Allahu Akbar. Obviously, there was no leads at the time, but I'm just giving you an example. So he went to the flame. And as he went, he heard Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speak to him. He realized when he drew closer. Listen very carefully. He realized when he drew closer that, you know what? This is not an ordinary flame. This is something else. Now, let me explain to you. One of the points of benefit is, we look at things from a distance. Sometimes we don't recognize them. Go slightly deeper and something might come out of that. Religiously, sometimes a person doesn't want to go to the masjid. They don't want to go to an Islamic function. They don't want to go where some sheikh is going to come and drill them, you know, drill their minds to say, you know, this is what you guys are supposed to be doing and not doing. They don't want to feel like, you know, they are wrong. Let me tell you, it's very good to feel that you're wrong, because that's when you can actually correct yourself if you are wrong. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. But sometimes we don't want to even get close. So when do we expect that guidance? When do we expect something to come in our direction? We need to walk towards guidance. Guidance will not come to you. You need to walk to it. You need to make an effort to learn. It will not suddenly plop into your head. There is no chip. There is no chip that I've seen. It might come later on. That plugs into your ear like a USB and suddenly, I know everything. Alhamdulillah. We doctors. How do you know? Wait, hang on. Oh, you want to know about the heart? Hang on. I've got the wrong chip. Let me put it in. Plug it in your ear. And next thing. Yes. Sorry. You've got a disease called this, this, this. How did you know? That's the chip. Allahu Akbar. There's nothing like that. You need to make an effort to go out. Why are we sitting here in Leeds? We want to learn, don't we? If we were sitting at home and we were doing correspondence, even that correspondence would require you to make an effort. Turn on the computer, do something, register, have this, have that. There are things required. You cannot just sit. You cannot just sit and expect something to plop from the ceiling. Look at the ceiling all your life, it won't. You probably will start seeing cracks after a moment, but that will be a mental disorder. There won't be cracks there. Keep on staring at the ceiling, maybe your eyes will crack then. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So this is a powerful verse. Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said, let me go towards the light. He went towards it. It didn't come towards him. So we all know that when he got there, he actually got prophethood and he came back with guidance. So the point, and I don't want to dwell on it more, meaning too much. The point is, we need to make an effort to learn about our religion. And that is when the doors of guidance will be opened. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in another place in the Quran,
وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا.
Those who strive and struggle to come closer to us, for them we shall open the doors of guidance. So we can't say, Ya Allah, grant me guidance. Ya Allah, grant me hidayah. Grant me guidance. Grant me guidance. And you're not making an effort. Ya Allah, get me up for Salatul Fajr. And then you sleep. And you get up at 8 in the morning and you say, you know what? I've missed it. That's Allah's fault, because I told him to get me up. Astaghfirullah. How can we say that? But the clock was right next to you and you didn't even set it. Amazing. So if you make an effort to set the clock, and when the clock rings, you make an effort to sit up and open the window slightly so the cold would actually irritate you a little bit. Amazing. That is when Allah will grant you the acceptance of getting up for Salatul Fajr. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us regular with Salatul Fajr. For definitely it is a salah that the angels take more, meaning they take a register of Salatul Fajr. Inna Qur'an al-Fajr kana mashhuda. Definitely that salah of Fajr is witnessed by the angels. They take a record, who was there, who wasn't. Not to say it doesn't happen for the other salawat, but Salatul Fajr is even more important. The hadith says, speaking about the two raka'at of sunnah before Fajr, a muttafaq alayh, correct hadith, it says, رَكَعَتَا الْفَجْرِ خَيْرٌ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا وَمَا فِيهَا. Those two raka'at that you would read before the farad of Fajr are better than the whole world and what it has. Allahu Akbar. So inshallah, I hope we are inspired to get up for Salatul Fajr. Wallahi, thumma wallah, I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you try it. Get up for Fajr solely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even if you are just to make your two raka'at of farad, tell me how you feel there on that particular day. You feel so good, so good. The rest of your day moves smooth. Try it. Believe me, I guarantee it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept us all, inshallah. And don't ever think you're bad. And you know, some people say, no, you know, I've got this weakness, that weakness, you know, I've got that, I'm doing that now. Why should I read salah? You know, I feel so hypocritical. No, start somewhere. Start somewhere. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take you further and further, inshallah. Start where, whatever is made easy for you, start and continue and move further and further. Never ever feel useless. Never. Never feel that you are beyond repair. No ways. Allah says it in the Quran.
قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.
Oh, say, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to my worshippers who have transgressed against themselves, never ever lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter what you have done. He will forgive all your sins by a mere word. Astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, I seek forgiveness. Done. Gone. Everything wiped out, as clear as the day you were born, on condition that you say it correctly, nicely, properly. You know what is the meaning of astaghfirullah? Astaghfirullah. Oh Allah, I'm a criminal. I've done wrong. I really admit that I was wrong. I seek your forgiveness and I'll try my best not to do it again. Please forgive me. And Allah says, my worship, I love you. You're forgiven. You're as pure as the day you were born. Now turn a new leaf and start. That's one. Astaghfirullah. That's it. So don't ever feel useless. This is the basis of Islam. Allah is most forgiving, most merciful. He guarantees that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taught us in many places in the Quran that if you are to try, that is when guidance will come, inshallah. You are to try to achieve something. You want to dress properly. For example, you need to try. You need to try to do it. And inshallah, it will come. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make me strong and all of us strong, inshallah.
And a very interesting point, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, after he went and he got the message, he came back to his family. How many of us, whenever we have a good message, would go back to family and friends and tell them, you know what, today we heard something solid, I'd like to share it with you. I know on many occasions, there are many women folk, sadly, who cannot go to the masjid, sometimes because there's no place for them there, because some of the masajid are built in such a way that they don't cater for women, sadly. And sometimes, even if there is a place for women, you find that because of their duties and responsibilities, they cannot make it. How many men would actually go back home and say, you know what, today I heard a talk, I'd like to spend half an hour explaining to you what I heard. Not with the idea, and this is a problem that we face, not with the idea of going only to say those things which really were on your side, so to speak. You know, they said women must cook, women must sit at home, they must obey, they must worship, and that's it. Did you hear that? And I'm telling you, that's what I heard today. That's nonsense. If that is what you know, this deen is all about, if that's what you think the deen is all about, then you've made a huge mistake. No, tell them those things that, you know, husbands are not meant to swear, they're meant to be loving, they're meant to be caring, that's what I heard today, and inshallah, my dear wife, I'm going to be just that, inshallah. They said anger is haram, so inshallah, I won't be angry. Allahu Akbar. And the same applies, obviously, even when the sisters have heard a good message, let's share it. Share it with as many people as you can. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, بَلِّغُ عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. Spread the message, convey it, even if it's one little verse, whatever you've heard, continue. And spread it, inshallah. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, let me go and I'll get guidance. Allah says, فَلَمَّا أَتَاهَا نُودِيَا مُوسَى. When he got to that particular flame, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called out, O Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, إِنِّي أَنَا رَبُّكَ فَخْلَعْنَا عَلَيْكَ. I am your Rabb. Sorry, the term Rabb, I've explained it to you. Rabb is one who has created you, one who brings you up, one who sustains you, one who nourishes, cherishes you, one who protects you, one who cures you, one who answers all your du'as, the one who, you know, your prayers, the one who listens to you and so on. All that is the one term, Rabb, subhanAllah. And from this we realize that the English language does not qualify to translate the Arabic language. It doesn't, sadly. And what do we learn from that? When we read the English translation, that is an attempt of man to try and explain to us what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. Ideally, we should try and learn the Arabic language so that we can understand it direct. Allahu Akbar. It will have a greater impact. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, take off your shoes because you are in a sacred land or on a sacred land, sacred valley. Why take off your shoes? A lot of the Mufassirin have mentioned a lot of things. And I just like to say one point. You see, if you are to look at this world, we are created in the world. When you let the world overtake you, we are created in the world, we meant to utilize whatever we have in this world in a way that inshallah will help us live our lives and inshallah within the conformity of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prescribed. And we want to get to the akhirah, we want to get to paradise inshallah. And that is the straight path. So we are in the world. It's wrong to say divorce yourselves from the globe. You know, like you have some people, they say, you know what? Studying is haram. Going to university is haram. This is haram. That's haram. You know, take yourselves right out. You've got to sit in the masjid and that's it. And you've got to just pray and that's it. There are some people who actually say that. They haven't understood that Allah would not have created us in the world if that was the case. We wouldn't have been created in the world. But we need to strike the correct balance. So Allah says, remove your shoes because you are in a sacred place. The shoe is the contact. The shoe is the point of contact with the earth, with the ground. If I'm walking, what connects me to the earth? The shoe. There are certain times, like the times of Salah, when I need to put aside absolutely everything that connects me to this dunya because I want to plug in with my creator. When we say Allahu Akbar, literally we are plugging in with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Plugging in. So would it be correct for us? Would it be correct for us to Say that we're plugging in with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we are not concentrating, we have no concentration, our cell phones are ringing. And nowadays, and I've seen it, people, when they're in salah and the cell phone rings, they take it out very quiet and they look at who's calling. Okay, I'm not so important. And they put it back in. I've seen it happening. Amazing. So, on one hand, your creator, you owe him a salah, you owe him a salah. And on the other hand, you're busy answering your cell phone, meaning you're cheating. You're looking, who are you cheating? You're looking at that mobile phone. You are you communicating with your creator or are you communicating with somebody else? I still haven't seen someone actually SMS in salah, but I'm sure if we put these CCTVs in the masjids, we probably find that happening. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us protection. One youngster came up to me, sorry, on a lighter note, and it's true, this is a true story. He came up to me and he says, you know, I heard that al-amalul kathir, which means when you make a lot of actions in salah, it actually destroys your salah. He says, what's the limit of it? And I told him, why are you asking? He says, no, there's certain things sometimes you have to do. And he didn't admit it, but I told him, do you want to answer your phone or what? He says, maybe, you know. And I said, subhanAllah, look at how far people have been. Obviously, he was a youngster, so we excused him. What if he was an adult, an older person? But this is what it is. We need to plug with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Total concentration. So, if your salah, if your shoes are actually clean, it's not prohibited to read salah if your shoes are actually clean. But we all are used to taking off our shoes because we don't know, the masjid is much cleaner and so on, and it's very uncomfortable to read with this type of shoe because this is not the same type of shoe, meaning mine and yours. It's not the same type of shoe that was worn at the time of the Prophet ﷺ, which was lighter, you know. This is much heavier, it's got a thick sole, so thick that if you were to sit with it, like how we sit when we are just about to make salam in the Qa'd al-Akhira, it would be quite difficult to sit in that position. So we remove our shoes completely, and we leave them outside the masjid, or outside the main section of the masjid. That should help us to think that all these worldly matters, my business and so on, I've got to leave it by the door. I've actually left it. I've come into the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nothing must disturb me besides my, meaning nothing must occupy me besides my salah. And I plug in with Allah. That is actually the qunut. That is standing for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with utmost concentration. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. And may He make us from amongst those who are calm in salah. The one hadith of the signs of Qiyamah says, يُوشِكُ أَن تَدْخُلَ مَسْجِدَ جَمَاعَةٍ فَلَا تَرَى فِيهِ رَجُلًا خَاشِعًا. There will come a time when you'll enter a masjid with jama'ah and you won't even find a single person concentrating. That's a sign of Qiyamah, which means we need to try our best to concentrate. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he got this nubuwa. Let me get to another point. He got it, he came back to his family and he continued and so on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then asked him questions. In fact, before he came back to his family, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him questions. You know, he was shocked. I mean, imagine you go there and suddenly you hear that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking. He was a Nabi, so he probably, Allah had prepared him already. Allah had prepared him already. But he was given this nubuwwah, it came as a shock to him, and it did. Because immediately he said something, and I'm getting to that. Allah says, وَمَا تِلْكَ بِيَمِينِكَ يَا مُوسَى. What is that in your right hand, O Moses? What is that in your right hand? Allah knows very well what is in his right hand. Now Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he had an opportunity because he just digested the fact that Allah says, you know what, I'm your Rabb, I'm your Allah, I'm talking to you. And he says, oh, that's Allah. As he digested it, he says, now he's asking me a question, what's in your right hand? What was in his right hand? A stick. He says, Hiya asaya, it is my stick. But he realized, you know what, I've been asked a question. I'm asked to speak. Let me continue. I want to talk. أَتَوَكَّأُ عَلَيْهَا وَأَهُشُّ بِهَا عَلَىٰ غَنَمِي وَلِيَ فِيهَا مَآرِبُ أُخْرَىٰ. He continued saying, you know, it's my stick. I lean on it sometimes and I use it to drive my sheep and so on. And I use it for so many other things, Ya Allah. You know, that's the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine he wanted to communicate with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more. You know, I don't know why. Every time what comes to my mind is, you see when you have youngsters on their mobile phones talking to the girl they're not supposed to be talking to, that's when they make the most use of the free minutes that I've heard about in Britain. Allahu Akbar. And then when it comes to salah, hang on, I'm quickly reading my salah, I'll call you back. That's if they read salah. Alhamdulillah, at least they read their salah.
And then suddenly, as soon as Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah is on the phone, Allahu Akbar.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding.
Isn't that a sign of connection? You want to speak to them more. Oh, how, what's the weather like? Is it raining? Are the droplets big? Okay, you measure them. Okay. And so on. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding.
We need to have that love with our Creator. So when we are to engage in salah, let's engage in salah in a proper way. That's a lesson we learn from here. When we engage in salah, let's engage in salah properly. Let's take our time when we're reading salah. Not just, people, I've heard that happening. Seriously. Take your time, relax. We spoke about Surah Al-Fatiha 2 days ago. Every verse you read, Allah responds. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. So give him that opportunity to respond. So, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us about salah and how we should be reading it. Read your salah as though it's the last salah you're ever going to read. That's how we're meant to be reading the salah. So Musa alayhi salatu wa sallam seized the opportunity and he spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he developed a link. Obviously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refers to him as Kalimullah. وَكَلَّمَ اللَّهُ مُوسَى تَكْلِيمًا. Allah says Allah has spoken to Musa alayhi salatu wa sallam. Proper speaking. So he was then given a mission. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him, go to Fir'aun. And immediately he made a dua. This dua is important for us here at this university and everywhere else. Allah says, go to Fir'aun for definitely, he has transgressed. Go and remind him. And immediately he says, رَبِّ شْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَحْلُلْ عُقْدَةً مِّن لِسَانِي يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي. Ya Allah, clear my chest, Ya Allah. رَبِّ شْرَحْ لِي صَدْرِي وَيَسِّرْ لِي أَمْرِي. Make this issue of mine easy. You've given me a mission. Make this issue of mine easy, Ya Allah. Surely we need to make that dua. We are here in this university. May Allah open, may Allah cleanse our chests, our hearts. And may really He open the doors for us and may He make these issues that we have easy for us, inshallah. Whether it is study, whether it is something else, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. Ishrah li sadri, Rabbi ishrah li sadri, wa yassir li amri, wa ahlul uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. Ya Allah, let the knot on my tongue be loosened. Unfasten the knot on my tongue so that they can understand what I want to say. So that they can understand the message. Allahu Akbar. Imagine he's a Nabi being given a mission by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he's made a dua. What about us? We are not anbiya. Do we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And the most important point I want to make about this is, let us try our best to read the du'as which were made by prophets that are mentioned in the Quran and in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which were responded positively by Allah. If we use the same words, it's not necessary to use the same words. No, I can use any words I want. Allah knows what I want to say even before I utter it. يَعْرِفُ سُؤْلَهُ حَتَّى قُبَيْلًا نُطْقِ بِالدَّعَوَةِ. Allah knows the question even before you utter it. You might not word it properly, He will word it for you, don't worry. You say, Ya Allah, you know my heart, grant whatever is in there, Ya Allah, you know it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. So, if we are to make the du'as that the previous prophets have made and they were accepted, there is a greater chance of acceptance. I give you a little example. If you have a combination lock or a little keypad on the door and you know that there are certain combinations that will open this door for the people who come in and you arrived at the door. Someone told you, look, try this number, that number, that number. They've worked in the past to open this door. I know that. And you say, no, hang on, I'm going to try my own numbers. You will try, you may get through, you may not get through. But if you say, look, what were those numbers? They worked? Yes, they did. Okay, this number, let me memorize it. You came to the door, you plugged it in, and inshallah, the door will open and you walk through. So, if Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made a specific dua, and you know that it was responded, and Allah granted him that particular item, surely, if you were to use the same blessed words, wouldn't it help a little bit more? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So it's good to read the Quran to find out these du'as. To find out when a person is in fear, let me read this du'a. It's in the Quran. When a person has this problem, this is the du'a. It's in the Quran. The others have made it. When a person wants good offspring, when a person wants a good spouse, and so there are du'as in the Quran that are mentioned, that were made by others. Those du'as are not there for no reason. They are there for reasons. In fact, if you take a look at Surah Al-Anbiya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, all the messengers have made dua to us and we've granted them. وَلَقَدْ نَادَانَا نُوحٌ فَلَنِعْمَ الْمُجِيبُونَ Allah says, وَنُوحًا إِذْ نَادَى When Nuh called out to us, then later he says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ We answered the dua. وَزَكَرِيَّا إِذْ نَادَى When Zakariya called out to us, Allah says, فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ We answered it. وَأَيُّوبَ إِذْ نَادَى When Ayyub called out, we answered it. فَاسْتَجَبْنَا لَهُ Allah continues to tell us, why does he say the Anbiya called out? Because for us who are not Anbiya, it's even more important to call out. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open the doors for all of us. I'm sure every single one of us seated here, and every single one of us who may listen to this particular talk later on, has a different problem, a different issue, maybe a different sickness, a different matter that is affecting them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open for us the doors in a manner that He deals with everybody's crises and makes everybody's issues easy and grants us all cure from the different sicknesses that we may have, inshallah, and He can do that wholesale just by this little dua. Allahu Akbar. So Musa alayhi salatu was salam, he was granted a mission and he made a dua. And he says, Rabbi shahili sadri, wa yassir li amri, wa ahlul uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. And he asked for assistance and so on. To move further up the surah, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about what he said when he told Musa alayhi salatu wa salam to go to Fir'aun. He told Musa and his brother, he says, فَقُولَا لَهُ قَوْلًا لَيِّنًا لَعَلَّهُ يَتَذَكَّرُ أَوْ يَخْشَى Go out and speak to him with a soft tone, with beautiful words, so that he might remember or he might take heed and be fearful. Let's pause there for a moment. Who was sent to who and what were they told? The best of the time was Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. He was the best person to exist at that moment. He was the Nabi of Allah, just granted nubuwwah by Allah, spoken to by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The best was sent to the worst. And Allah says, speak to him nicely, hang on, speak to him, relax. Calm tone, use the best of words so that he might take heed. What do we learn from this? Am I the best in the world? No. Are you the best in the world? No. And when we want to remind someone to read their salah, are they the worst in the world? No. Can we compete with Musa alayhi salatu wasalam? No. Can they be at the level of Fir'aun? No. So surely we should be speaking to them in an even better manner than Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was asked to speak to Fir'aun because he was the best speaking to the worst. We are not the best and we're not speaking to the worst. Allahu Akbar. And this teaches us something else. When you want someone to listen to a message, you need to speak to them with respect, no matter what they are doing. Nobody can be worse than Fir'aun. And if Fir'aun was meant to be spoken to very, very calmly with the best of words, when you want to remind someone to read their salah or to do something good, you need to speak to them very, very calmly, especially when they're your children, when they're related to you, when they're part of the Muslim Ummah, and even when they're non-Muslims. Allahu Akbar, speak to them calm. No non-Muslim on earth today can be equivalent to Fir'aun. No ways. Not at all. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So it was the duty of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam to go and remind Fir'aun in a nice way. Listen, you know what? This is not right. What you're doing is actually incorrect. This is the dialogue that we're talking about. Speaking to them, answering questions, you know, letting them have a say. And in the surah, there is a dialogue between the worst of this whole world at that particular time and the best. And the dialogue is mentioned in the surah. We don't really have time to go into it, but look at it and you will see the questions. One asks a question, the other answers. The other asks a question, the other answers, and so on. Allahu Akbar, there we are. Now today there are people who say, no, you're not allowed to talk. You know, you don't say anything. These are non-Muslims and just, you know, leave them. Allahu Akbar, it's our duty to interact with them in a beautiful manner within the limits of Islam for them to see the beautiful message of this religion because it is so beautiful. Believe me. So that is the understanding we get from this particular surah. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us something else in this particular surah. A very interesting point. You know, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam went to get the book. He went for a certain number of days. And he left Harun alayhi salatu wasalam with Banu Israel. And they began to worship a calf that was made out of the jewelry. A man called Samiri had made, it's mentioned in the surah, had made a calf. And that calf was hollow. So when the wind blew, it made a noise. Ooh, ooh. You know when you hear a sound in the window, when you're sleeping, you hear it 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, then you say somebody's cast a spell. Allahu Akbar. May Allah protect us. I know, seriously, of people who have invited me to their homes. And they've told me, please come into this room. You know what? There is a sound I hear every night and it's been going on for a long time. And I say, okay. You know what you need to do? This tree, cut it off. Cut it down. Okay, no problem. Will it sort the problem? Yes, it will. Okay. Tree gone, sound gone. Everything gone. They went around saying, you know, this Mufti, he came to us and there was a jinn in the tree. So he told us to cut the tree. Allahu Akbar, there was just a sound. The wind was making a noise. What jinn are you talking about? You know, it reminds me of the young girls, with no offense to anyone who's seated here, who want to look like Jennifer Lopez and so on. And suddenly, they stop eating. And suddenly, they can't sleep. No, there's nothing in the stomach. And suddenly, they hear sounds. And suddenly, they see stars. And suddenly, something talks to them. And then, they feel possessed. It happens. It has happened. Believe me, people have come to me with this problem. And the mom brings the daughter along, you know what? Someone has done something to this girl. She's just not right. Don't know what's happened. I said, yes. Now, if you tell her, look, there's nothing wrong, go back home and stop dieting, she will hate your guts. So sometimes you've got to say, you know what? There is a problem. And the only way to deal with the problem, the hadith says, المؤمن القوي خير وأحب إلى الله من المؤمن الضعيف. A stronger mu'min is better than the one who's weak and so on. You need to eat at least 50 grams of chocolate a day. And you need to have at least one little cup of yogurt every morning that will kick away all these evil effects. And you need to have a little bit of red meat. And you need to have this and that. You know what? They go back, they start the remedy, and indeed, the stars are gone, everything's gone, they feel better. The mom starts telling everyone, there was a jinn in my daughter and this mufti took it out. Allahu Akbar. That jinn was a jinn called dieting. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. Really. And the reason I'm mentioning this is because it makes our iman weak sometimes. No matter what we'd like to, in fact here, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam had gone out and Fir'aun, meaning Harun alayhi salatu wasalam was left. There was a man called Samiri who'd made this calf. It started making a sound and the people began to say, oh, that calf, okay, it's making a sound. Hey, this must be something important. And he attracted them to worship it. Allahu Akbar. Even in the presence of a Nabi, he attracted them to worship an idol. We need to understand, my dear brothers and sisters, every day of your life, ask yourselves, has anyone tried to deviate me from worshipping solely my Creator? Allahu Akbar. If they could come, if Shaytan could come, if Shaytan could come to people in the presence of a Nabi and convince them about something which was very, very deviant, we need to ask ourselves on a daily basis, Shaytan definitely comes to us every day and tries his tricks. So if we think Shaytan didn't come to me today, for 1 day, we definitely have fallen into his trap somewhere. How did Shaytan come to me? And Shaytan's interest is to get you to associate partners with Allah. That's the prime interest. He promised Allah that, Ya Allah, I will show you they will worship everything but you. They will trust, they will lay their trust in everything but you. And that's what he's proving. So we need to ask ourselves, am I a proper believer? Do I believe in the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Is my belief and conviction in my Creator, is it intact? Or do things come to me really on a daily basis? Do I tend to start worshipping things and people and so on? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So there was a problem because when Harun alayhi salatu wasalam began to remind the people, they wanted to fight him back. He wasn't as solid as Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. And this shows us that whenever you remind someone of something that is correct, you'll probably face opposition. You will probably face opposition when you want to correct someone. You will probably face opposition. Or when you want to make yourself a little bit more or a little bit closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you may face opposition. I know of some sisters, they've moved. This is just an example. I mean, I know of what has happened here. No offense to anyone. They've moved from a miniskirt to a jeans. From a miniskirt to a jeans. Don't you think it's a huge achievement? They're now covering their legs. It's a huge achievement. And they face opposition, sometimes from their own peers who were used to seeing them in a specific dress code. People from that jeans, for example, they then decided, you know what, I think I need to cover my hair. Their family begins to tell them, why are you becoming a nun? For what? Come on, enjoy yourself. Be free. But that was their choice. Nobody forced them, because if somebody forced them, they would become hypocrites. And it's worse to be a hypocrite. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. But at the same time, when we want to come closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we may face opposition from our own family members sometimes. You get up for Salatul Fajr, someone will tell you, you know what, that clock disturbs the whole house. You're the only nun in the house and we don't want you to disturb us. Thank you. It happens. You might hear comments of that nature. This is something you need to understand. Harun alayhi salatu wasalam, they told him, you know what, you just keep quiet. We don't want to listen to you. He said, hey, you, this is all wrong. You know, we've been given a task by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is wrong. They said, listen, you know what, you just stay away. And Harun alayhi salatu wasalam was concerned about dividing the ummah. This is a massive point. Harun alayhi salatu wasalam was concerned about splitting those who were united. So what he did, they were engaged in shirk, which is the biggest crime. Association of partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He tolerated it for a few moments, for a little while. He didn't like it. He spoke to them. He reminded them about it. But he had to tolerate it for a while because he felt, if I make two groups, there's a part who's ready to listen to me and they are listening to me. And if I divide them from those who are not listening to me right now, I'm going to create two groups of one. And then we will be split forever. When Musa alayhi salam comes back with the book, he will tell me, why did you divide these people here when they were all united? This shows us that it is not easy to maintain unity, but it is very, very important to maintain unity. Even sometimes if for a little moment, you've got to give up your view. And I'd like to tell you that to give up your view for another view is one of the biggest acts of worship, for as long as both views are within the Sharia. You want to eat pizza and she wants to have fish. To say, okay, we'll have fish. It's a very big act of worship. Allahu Akbar. Give up your view. You will achieve contentment. Allahu Akbar. And I told you, within the limits of the Sharia. It doesn't mean we give up our views. Someone says, you know what, I'd like you to come to the nightclub. And you say, well, let me give up my view. We were told by that sheikh to give up our view. So I'm going to the nightclub. I didn't want to, but that was, you know. Don't use this religion in that way. Allahu Akbar. I'm meaning those things which are within the limits of Islam, inshallah, give up your view. It'll make you so happy, especially when you're married, both men and women. You want your marriage to work? Remember, it's a sacrifice. Marriage is not just, you know, a game. It's not just a pastime. It is a big sacrifice. And if you're not ready to sacrifice, it probably won't work. You need to give up your views sometimes. And that is what will make you happy. She wants a red vehicle, you want a white one. So you tell her, we'll buy a red vehicle, but when it comes to the house, I will choose the location. Alhamdulillah. You can. So then she'll say, no, get the white vehicle, I'll choose the house. There we are. So it's something give and take. Allahu Akbar, we need to understand. Harun alayhi salatu wasalam chose. He said, you know what? I'm going to tolerate this for a moment and wait for Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. When Musa alayhi salam came back, he saw that the people were worshipping an idol. And he asked Harun alayhi salatu wasalam, whilst he was very angry, he says, مَا مَنَعَكَ إِذْ رَأَيْتَهُمْ ضَلُّوا أَلَّا تَتَّبِعَنِي أَفَعَصَيْتَ أَمْرِي. Why didn't you stop them? What made you not stop these people when they were worshipping these idols? Why have you gone against what I told you? And he says, يَبْنَ أُمَّ. Imagine he had a beard and Musa alayhi salam caught his hair and his beard and shook him and said, hey, what's your problem? Please, let's not do that to him, inshallah. So, that was his brother. He was just I don't know if it was very hard, but we know it's mentioned that he was holding the beard in the head. He says,
يَبْنَ أُمَّ لَا تَأْخُذْ بِنِحْيَتِي وَلَا بِرَأْسِي. Oh my brother,
don't hold me with my beard in my head. Don't.
إِنِّي خَشِيتُ أَن تَقُولَ فَرَّقْتَ بَيْنَ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلِ.
I fear that if I told them, and if I reprimanded them, you would have come back and said, why have you divided Banu Israel into two? And that division may have lasted forever. So I tolerated it. Waiting for you. Not to say I agreed with it. No, he didn't agree with the sheikh. But he let it pass for a little while with the reminders. So with us, we will need to tolerate certain things. Do you know the Muslim Ummah today? We have so many madahib, so many schools of thought. We have so many different sects within the Muslim Ummah. The truth is, there are a lot of these sects which fall within the framework of what is known as a broader Muslim. Let's take them for that. Let's never exclude people. This person is not a Muslim, that one's a kafir, that one's a this. Oh, that's very dangerous. Extremely dangerous. Someone is a Hanafi, Maliki, Shafi'i, Hanbali, Salafi, what have you. They're all Muslimin. And they're all good Muslims, inshallah. They're all trying to get closer to Allah. Every single one of us here, we are trying to get closer to our Creator. Alhamdulillah, I want Jannah, you want Jannah. I love the Prophet, you love the Prophet. I want to follow him and so do you. Alhamdulillah. So let's move together, inshallah. And there are so many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What I've taken is not from my pocket. It's from there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to tolerate one another as Muslimin. I know of people, a Hanafi won't talk to a Shafi'i sometimes, I know. And sometimes a Salafi may come and say, deviant brothers, the brothers are deviant. Out. Why? For what? Sometimes it's not even good to reveal what you are. Sometimes it's not good, depending on where you are. If you'd like to invite people, invite them. From the message, they'll pick it up. Allahu Akbar. And remember this, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So, here we have Harun alayhi salatu wasalam tolerated this to keep the Muslim Ummah united. Today, if we are to tolerate one another, I think we would resolve most of our problems. The biggest issues we have, and you all do know, are the issues within the Muslim Ummah. Mudslinging. People pointing at each other, people labeling each other, people thinking they're wrong, they're on the wrong path. Believe me, you can have more than one right path. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told his companions, لا يصلينا أحدكم العصر إلا في بني قريبة, the hadith which makes mention of Banu Qurayba. Banu Qurayba, after one of the battles, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was instructed to go to a certain place because the war was not over, there were some enemies there. So he instructed his companion, he says, do not read Salatul Asr until you get to Banu Qurayba. Listen carefully. Do not read Salatul Asr until you get to Banu Qurayba. So immediately the Sahaba understood that and they began to rush towards Banu Qurayba. The time of Asr was coming to expire. So the Sahaba were two groups. Regarding what? Regarding Salah. This is very important. Listen to it. Regarding Salah, there were two groups of Sahaba. The one said, let's read Salah because the time is expiring. And we've got to read our Asr before the time expires. And the other said, no, today we heard the instruction of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Salatul Asr today is not connected to a time, it's connected to a place. So we're not worried about what time we read it, we've got to read it in Banu Qurayba. He said, don't read your Salatul Asr until you get to Banu Qurayba, which means today's Asr is not connected to a time, it's connected to a place. So it will not be valid unless you read it in Banu Qurayba. That's the hadith, instruction. Commander of the army. Allahu Akbar. So some of the Sahaba said, no, hang on, you know, we've understood differently. So they agreed, look, you guys do as you've understood and we'll do what we've understood. What was the issue at stake? Salah, the one of the most important elements of Islam. The hadith says, As-salatu imadu ad-dini, faman aqamaha faqad aqama ad-dini wa man hadamaha faqad hadama ad-din. Salah is one of the strongest pillars of Islam. Whoever uplifts it has uplifted the entire deen, and whoever drops it has dropped the deen. Allahu Akbar. So what happened? When they got to Banu Qurayza As this group read their salah and they got to Banu Qurayza, they noticed the other group had just finished their salah. Because the lapse was exactly the time of Salatul Asr. Whether you stop at this services or the services right near your destination, you've still stopped at the services and you've still utilized the same amount of time. So you probably would have got there at the same time at the function you wanted to get to, for example. So they asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, this is what happened. You know what he said? One narration says that he asked them, why did you do what you did? They said, well, that's what we understood, we wanted to follow you. And why did you do what you did? He says, well, that they said, well, that's what we understood from you, we wanted to follow you. He said, do you know what? You're both correct. Allahu Akbar. You are both correct. Both of you are right. These were two opposite views, heading in totally opposite direction. One said, read salah, one said, don't read salah. One said, delay it until it's expired. And the other one said, no, read it now, salah. Two opposite views and they were both correct. That's why I said, sometimes you can have more than one view, that's also correct. Allahu Akbar. You see the evidence of that? So don't only think, you know, this is my way, it's the only way. Whether you tie your hands here or there, or put them down, it's all correct, believe me. Allahu Akbar. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. So this is the tolerance that we learn, even in this particular surah. And then, I'd like to mention, I was going to speak about the story of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, but inshallah, that story repeats itself so many times in the Quran. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us another opportunity in this particular university, possibly sometime next year, inshallah, we might speak about that. But let me end with something very important. I am standing here today. This is from this surah. I am standing here today. Is it by chance that I'm here? No. There is a crowd of people in front of me. Wallahi, the link between me and you is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the deen we have. That's it. And I'm not interested in what sect you are and what have you. The fact that you say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have a link. That's it. That's the bond. You might get to Jannah before me. You may. And if you do, inshallah, you make sure that you pull me through, inshallah. I tell you, I'm here not by chance. Do you know what the hadith says? مَا أَصَابَكَ لَمْ يَكُلْ لِيُخْطِئَكَ What got to you was never ever meant to miss you. Taqdeer, any form of predestiny that got to you was never meant to miss you. And what missed you was never ever meant to get to you. Amazing. That hadith applies today as well. I'm sitting here, who would have dreamt that somebody born in Zimbabwe, in the heart of Africa, sorry, not the heart, in the knee of Africa, it's a little bit lower down. Somebody born right there, you know, studied in some system. We studied in the British system because we were colonized by the British. So studied there, grew up, you know, went to Medina, came back, you know, we don't even know what he does, you know. And he's sitting here today in front of us talking. What is he telling us? I hope the message is solid. I hate fairy tales, to be honest with you. A message should be solid. What's our reaction? How are we going to react to it? Has it affected us? If it got to my ears, wallahi, it was never meant to miss my ear. Whatever I heard today, whatever you heard today, whatever I said today, whatever you've heard, every single one of you, was never ever meant to miss your ears. And do you know what? You're going to be asked about it on the day of Qiyamah. مَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ إِلَّا سَيُكَلِّمُهُ رَبُّهُ لَيْسَ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَهُ تُرْجُمَانَ Every single one of you, Allah will speak to you directly without a translator between the two of you. You will answer for everything. Allahu Akbar. Are you ready for that? Allah's going to ask you, one day somebody came to you and they reminded you of something. What happened? Did it affect you? Did you change your life a little bit, even an inch? You know, wallahi, if we move 1 millimeter after tonight, we've achieved. 1 millimeter after tonight, we've achieved. Wallahi, wallahi. Even if your heart moves, maybe you physically might be intact. But even if your heart moves a little millimeter, wallahi, we've achieved. So the hadith is going to, meaning that the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ tells us that we're going to be questioned about everything. When you engage in istighfar, Allah wipes it out. And it is not like the formatting of a hard drive, because now there's technology that you put some form of software and it brings back everything you've deleted. Even what you formatted, it can come back, retrieve information. No, it's deleted completely.
when you engage in istighfar. So if you want to be a friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala now, you just need to say, Ya Allah, forgive me, and I promise you I'm going to return, and I'm going to come closer to you, Ya Allah. And that's my decision and resolution. Allah, you become a friend of Allah just by having that in your mind. Amazing. May Allah make it easy for all of us. Why I say this is, there's a verse towards the end. Allah says,
وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى.
Those who turned away from our messages, those who turned away from our signs, those who turned away from our remembrance and did not remember us and our existence, Allah says, firstly, they will not lead a content life. They won't be happy in the world. They will have issues and problems, and they will have this and that. Through Allah's mercy, He might give them respite. He might grant them some years. But Allah says, and then on the day of Qiyamah, they will be resurrected blind.
قال ربي لما حشرتني أعمى وقد كنت بصيرا.
They will say, oh my Rabb, why did you resurrect me blind when I could see when I was alive on the earth? And Allah says,
كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا فَنَسِيتَهَا وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى.
Didn't our signs come to you? Weren't our verses read out to you? And you turned a blind eye to them, you forgot us, so today we've made you blind, we've forgotten you. Goodbye. There we are. That's a solid verse. Very powerful. We don't want to be forgotten by Allah. So if you don't want to be forgotten by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I don't want to be forgotten by Allah, what is the way forward? Allah says, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Remember me, I'll remember you.
تعرف إلى الله في الرخاء يعرفك في الشدة.
The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala during your days of ease when nothing is wrong. Raise your hand and say, Allah, I thank you. You've granted me so much, Ya Allah. I really thank you. I appreciate it. I'm going to read 5 salah for you and I'm going to do this, this, this. There we are. Alhamdulillah. Get close to Allah during the time when you were at ease, and when you are in difficulty, Allah will get closer to you. Meaning, He will be there before you even ask. Allahu Akbar. And that proves to us that life is not just a walk. The best of creation, and all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have been through turbulence and turmoil throughout their lives. So it doesn't mean when you're a Muslim and you're right, and you're on the right path, and you read your salah, and you try your best to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Obviously, we're all moving in different paces. It doesn't mean that if you're trying your best, calamity won't come in your direction, difficulties won't come in your direction, and other issues won't come in your direction. No, they will. Those are different tests, and the test will be bigger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us through the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ إِذَا أَحَبَّ عَبْدًا ابْتَلَاهُ. When Allah loves a worshipper, He tests him more. You have a bigger test. You know why? Sabr is an act of worship that cannot be engaged in unless you have some issue, some problem, some difficulty. And the reward of sabr is so great that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I myself become close to the person who engages in sabr. So you will gain that closeness to Allah, you will gain Allah's closeness to you through the act of sabr, which is impossible unless a difficulty comes into your life. So Allah chooses certain people to get closer to, so He grants them a problem so that they can engage in sabr, and through that sabr He becomes then closer to them. So sabr is an act of worship that draws you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Had it not been for that sabr, you would not have been, or had it not been for the problem, you wouldn't have been able to engage in this huge act of worship known as sabr. Allahu Akbar. I've said it round and round in a few different ways. I hope you've understood that. So don't think that now I'm on the straight path and inshallah, you know, nothing will go wrong. Things, meaning you might face difficulty, people might laugh at you, scoff at you, your family, your this issue, that issue, marriage issues and so on. May Allah make it easy for everyone, inshallah. Continue making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Inshallah, that's the way forward. And remember the day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask you about not only this message that was delivered today, any CD you've heard with a correct message, any cassette You might have heard any book you may have read, anyone who spoke to you that may have got to you. If it got to your ears, it was tailor-made for your ears, and you will be questioned about how you treated the information that got to you. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with all of us, inshallah. And really, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant every single one of us acceptance, inshallah. And those who may listen to this later on, they'll probably be far more in number, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant them mercy as well. Remember one thing, we are all equals here. We're all trying to head in the same direction, and nothing should make us feel that the person sitting next to me is worse than me spiritually, because that itself is an action of shaitan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the lessons that we've learned today from Surah Taha. I told you they were selected, and may we be able to be from amongst those whose hearts have softened up for the Quran, who can make an intention to try and learn the meaning of the Quran and to apply it in our lives. And inshallah, in that way, we will get closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because this is his book, the most powerful speech. Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, when he heard these four verses, he began to cry. And he says, take me to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when he was taken to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib was standing at the door. The house was the house of Al-Arqam ibn Abi Al-Arqam radiallahu anhu. And Hamza radiallahu anhu looked at this man with some blood on him, with a sword. And he knew he's the enemy. And he knew the dua that was made by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, Allahumma hadha Umar, in yuridi Allahu bihi khayran yuslim, wa in yakun ghayra dhalika, yakun qatluhu alayna hayyina. Those were his words. He said, oh Allah, this is Umar. You know him. If you intend goodness, let him accept this deal. And if anything else he intends, then make it easy for us to overcome him. And he walked in, he saw the people. He was the 40th person to accept Islam, according to the books of Ibn Hisham, of Seerah. And he says, Ya Rasulullah, inni ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka abduhu wa rasuluhu. O Messenger of Allah. The minute he said, O Messenger of Allah, all those who were seated there knew that this man has now confirmed messengership to this particular person. It means he's accepting Islam. They began to say, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Amazing. And they heard the statement and they were softened. They were crying, some of them, and they were just declaring the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, he looked at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first question he says, Ya Rasulullah, alasna ala al-haq? Are we not on the right path? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Bala, yes we are. We're on the right path. He says, okay, so let's go to the Masjid al-Haram and we'll read salah in public. Who will say anything? Come, let's go. Allahu Akbar. Wasn't the dua, Ya Allah, grant strength to Islam by one of the two Umars? Four verses of Surah Taha, they moved the man completely. What made him know about salah? He knew about it already, imagine. He knew about it already, salah. And that's when they made two safs. Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib was standing in the front of one of them, and Umar ibn Khattab was standing in the front of the other, and they marched to the Haram, and they read their first salah with the jama'ah in the Haram at that moment. And nobody said anything. They were just looking. He's joined them. Ooh, Michael Jackson. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. I said that obviously for a reason, and I'm sure you're aware of it. Meaning people are shocked when someone accepts Islam, they say, what? So he wasn't that bad after all. Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really grant us all hidayah. Remember, that's why I say even the Muslims and the non-Muslims, don't underestimate who's going to get to Jannah before. Believe me, do not underestimate who's going to get to Jannah before. You might look at Britney Spears today. Tomorrow she might be Khadija Spears, who knows? Allahu Akbar. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all acceptance. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.